So it's my pleasure to present Associate Professor of Political Studies and Human Rights, the Academic Director of the Huron Center of Politics and Humanities at Bard College, Roger Berkowitz. Roger has a BA from Amherst. He has a PhD from the Polk Hall School of Law at the University of California. And it's my pleasure to welcome him. He's got, as he said, many, many editions of the book, and he brought one of them to take his notes from. So Roger, thank you very much for your generosity.
Earthly. And insofar as we're earthly, We are like other earthly beings. And what we share with them above all is that we are alive. We live. Earth being alive is a quintessence of the human condition. But if you look two sentences down, what she says is, the human artifice of the world separates human existence from all mere animal environment. But life itself is outside this artificial world. And through life, man remains related to all other living organisms. So what we have here is human artifice on one side and life on the other. Man is both a living being and a being who is occupied in human artifice, art, making, creating, building. And she says, a great many scientific endeavors have been directed toward making life artificial, cutting the last tie through which even man belongs amongst the children of nature, namely creating life in test tube, drones, clones, you name it. This is a dream of escaping the human condition. What is the human condition? Earth. What does Earth mean? On the one hand, being alive, but then she'll explain it next in the second part, the next paragraph. This future man, whom the scientists tell us they will produce in no more than 100 years, so the book is now about 60 years old. I think her estimation is going to be about right, and almost agrees perfectly with Ray Kurzweil. Seems to be possessed by a rebellion against human existence as it has been given, a free gift from nowhere, secularly speaking, which he wishes to exchange, as it were, for something he has made himself. The opposition here is between earthly life, which is given, a free gift from nowhere, in which we don't have control, in which, like all other living beings around, we simply are at the mercy of fortune. We are thrown, in a Heideggerian sense, into a world not of our making. And on the other hand, a humanly artificial world in which we make the world in which we live. And what she's suggesting is that there has been a 2,000-year-old dream since the Greeks. The greatest thinker of this was Sophocles, who in the Ode to Man, in his play Antigone, says, man is Danon, right? Danon is a fantastically interesting Greek word, which on the one means, hand means wonder. Man is a wonder, but he's a horror. He both can do all these things and escape himself and the condition in which he's born, but in doing so, he threatens himself because as man, he's also one subject to fate and chance. And Arendt is situating herself specifically in that question of what is man, the human condition. Man as both earthly and worldly. And what she says here is that there is no reason to doubt our abilities to exchange our living existence for our artificial existence. The question is only whether we wish to use our new scientific and technical knowledge in this direction. And this question cannot be decided by scientific means. It is a political question of the first order. And what she means by that is simply that it is a question for all humans, all men. This is what the book is about. The book is going to sketch for you the ways in which we are on the verge of exchanging the human condition for another condition. She will not name what that other condition is. But what she says is, there are certain basic aspects of the human condition which have been constant for 2,000 some odd years. She does not call it human nature. I want that to be very clear. She says, there's nothing in human nature that would prevent us from changing the human condition, from making man into something and something that is that is beyond his own control, that is spontaneous and free and unpredictable, to making man into something predictable, orderly, and following the laws of reason and science. There's nothing in the nature of man that prevents that from happening. In fact, in the nature of man is that choice. But as we've understood man for 2,000 years in art, in politics, in philosophy, man has never been able to make that full exchange. And it's always been there as a question. And what she's saying here is that somewhere in the next 100 years, writing in 1958, man will actually have the ability to make this question, to answer this question, to decide. Maybe not fully, right? But pretty darn close. And what she's saying is, I can't tell you whether we should or shouldn't, but we have to make the decision, and we should make it awake. We should make it with our eyes wide open. And so the book is an attempt to, as she said, think what we are doing, later down on page 3. It's simply an attempt to think what we are doing, namely eviscerating the human condition as it's understood for 2,000 some odd years, and changing it, replacing it with something else. Do we want to do that? I'm sorry, that's on page 5, where she says, two-thirds of the way down the page, what I propose, therefore, is very simple. It is nothing more than to think what we are doing. That is what this book is an attempt to think. One of the least talked about aspects of this book, but one that I find absolutely essential to what Arendt is doing, and it's talked about so little probably because it's so controversial, is her discussion of immortality. And this goes directly to her interest in art. So I talked before about earth versus world, right? The core of what she means by world is art. Art, artifice, art is how humans make a world. And we'll get into what that means and how that means. But it is a world that is lasting and enduring, and thus offers immortality. So on pages 17 through 21, she discusses the difference between eternity and immortality. Again, these are almost never talked about in literature on our end, but I just wanted to point out, first I'll say what the difference between eternity and immortality is. Eternity is what we think of when we think of Augustine. It is the philosophical idea that there are truths that exist eternally in time. So Plato's ideas, Augustine's Christian principles. These are the higher principles, non-negotiable in the polis. Arendt sees this philosophical attack on the polis as dangerous. For her, politics is, and can only be, what she calls a work of art, a task and potential greatness of morals, to produce things, namely works, deeds, and words, that deserve immortality. What humans do in artifice and building a world, what they can do when they do it the best, and we have to start talking about things like best if you're going to read Arendt and try and understand what she's talking about. The only excellent people and the excellent artists are those who produce things that are immortal, that endure. And so let's read this very problematic, not problematic, thought to be problematic, quote on page 19. The task and potential greatness of mortals, right? We don't talk this way. The task and potential greatness of mortals lie in their ability to produce things. Works, deeds, and words, which would deserve to be, and at least to a degree, are at home in everlastingness, This is not eternity. This is not things that are by their nature eternal ideas. These are works and deeds that deserve to be. The only way you can ask that is through judgment, right? That's a deserve to be ever at home in everlastingness, so that through them mortals could find their place in a cosmos where everything is immortal except themselves. This is how man becomes more than just another living creature. So, right, on the one hand, earth is the quintessence of the human being, but don't make a mistake. The humanly artificial world is where humans separate themselves from other living beings. And then we go on. By their capacity for the immortal deed, by their ability to leave non-perishable traces behind, men, their individual mortality notwithstanding, attain an immortality of their own and prove themselves to be of a divine nature. The distinction between man and animal runs right through the human species itself. Only the best, the Aristoi, who constantly prove themselves to be the best, and who prefer immortal fame to mortal things, are really human. The others, content with whatever pleasures nature will yield them, live and die like animals. So, a lot of you will find this problematic. Let me, before telling you you should or shouldn't, let me tell you what I think she is saying and what I think she's not saying. She is not saying that there is anyone who's not a human being. And she's not saying that there's anyone who doesn't deserve the right to have rights, which is her version of the human rights. She is, throughout her work, in all of her work, arguing against what she considers to be the coming and even present superfluous or making superfluous of human beings. There is nothing in Hannah Arendt that would deny anyone their humanity. That said, there is in Hannah Arendt a belief and a conviction that while we all have the potential to be human, most of us will not live up to it. Most of us don't even care or want to be it. That doesn't make us less valuable. It doesn't make us killable or superfluous. She's very clear about this. I can't go into the whole thing, but she is. But that doesn't scare her from saying that when we think about the human condition and what it is that makes us human, part of it is that what distinguishes us from animals is that, unlike animals who are distinguished by their ability to live, which we share with them, we have an ability to build something, which is immortal. Artworks, poems, states, relationships, anything that's immortalized in stories, in deeds, and in monuments. That is what makes humans human. Part of the reason that we are in danger of losing the human, or changing the human condition, is that we no longer believe in the importance of immortality. We no longer fundamentally share the conviction that what makes humans humans is their ability to create things that deserve to be immortal. And that is, and it's that retreat from the concern with immortality. And insofar as immortality is the creation of a world that perseveres and lasts because it deserves to, and worldliness is part of what it means to be human, this retreat from immortality is a retreat from our humanity. That is a big part of what this book is about. It's asking to what extent we the care that we're losing our human connection to immortality. And my guess is that most people don't care. And I'm very clear about that. She thinks artists are the one group of people who should care. Because artists, as she understands artists, and I understand this will be a controversy from the definition of artists, are people who actually spend their time trying to make things that are excellent, and that therefore deserve to be enduring. And I'm guaranteed most artists don't agree with that. But that's how she understands artists. I'm just trying to explain the book. I'll defend it. I'm happy to have that conversation. I want you to understand it. It's difficult. All right, the public and private realm section is one of my favorite. They're all one of my favorites. I can say that to everyone. I'm going to skip it. Not because I don't think it's important. I'll come back to parts of it. How much can you do? I want to talk about artists, and that's not central to the public-private section right now. Let's start with the way the book is structured is there's this chapter on public-private. The public-private chapter is about our retreat from both the public world and the private world into a world that she calls the social. It's about the loss of depth. And how in focusing on the social, which is the socialized man, the man who is the same, we lose our interest and our engagement in the places where man can distinguish himself, be different, namely in the private realm where he can be unique, and the public realm where he can act and speak in ways that are noticed, noticeable, and worthy of being preserved in monuments and artworks. And the rise of the social for her is the retreat of the two realms in which excellence can be nurtured and recognized, namely the private and the public realm. She then has chapters 3, 4, and 5 on labor, work, and action. And there's nothing that annoys me more than when people go on and on about Hannah Arendt. Oh, labor, oh, work, oh, action. Because as if one is important or the other is important, or as if this is where her philosophy lies. It's really not. I mean, she's asking a very simple question. What is the human condition? And she says, well, there's a lot of different things I could answer. But there's sort of three things, she says, that at least from the Greeks until 1950, all of us think are part of what it means to be human. We need to labor. We need to produce what we need to live through labor. We need to work, which means we build a world in which we all live together in, that endures. And we act, in which we act in such a way that we surprise and inspire others so that we come together and say, wow, that was interesting. Let's join together and we build lasting communities. Action, work, and labor are three things she thinks all humans can do and that humans have done and have considered essential to being human for thousands of years. There are other things that humans do that she thinks not all humans can or will do, like thinking. And she leaves that out. She says that's not something that most people at most times do. Where almost all people at all times labor, work, and act. Labor is associated with consumer goods in the end and consumption. But the basic, if you want to know the basic formula to understand the labor chapter, which I'm, is labor equals life, equals a cycle of life, equals fertility, equals happiness. What does all that mean? In labor, we produce products like bread. It's our best example, food. And in producing food, we produce it and it's consumed and it disappears. We don't labor to produce something that lasts. We labor to produce the life of the species. In laboring, which is at the quintessence of the human condition, is our earthliness, it's what connects us to ants and bees. It's absolutely, it's important. And to the extent you don't labor and you have slaves do your labor for you, she says, you are depriving yourself of part of your humanity, because part of being human is to labor. The dream of laboring society has been for a long time that if we labor well enough and efficiently enough, we would be able to create enough surplus labor to free ourselves of the need to labor and thus have time to do other things. Right? The problem is, she says, that dream has proven to be a fantasy. When we succeed in laboring efficiently enough that we produce surplus labor and thus have spare time and don't need to labor, we don't then go and do other things. We consume labor, and consume and labor some more. So, on page 133, she writes, "The hope that inspired Marx and the best men of the various workers' movements that free time eventually will emancipate men from necessity and make the animal laborans productive rests on the illusion of a mechanistic philosophy which assumes that labor power, like any other energy, can never be lost, so that if it is not spent and exhausted in the drudgery of life, it will automatically nourish higher other activities." Right? The guiding model of this hope in Marx was doubtless in the Athens of Pericles, which in the future, with the help of the vast increased productivity of human labor, would need no slaves to sustain itself. Namely, Pericles Athens needed slaves so that the aristocrats could, you know, do politics and, you know, play darts and whatever they wanted to do with their free time. 100 years after Marx, she concludes, though, we know the fallacy of his reasoning. The spare time of the animal laborans is never spent in anything but consumption, and the more time left to him, the greedier and more craving his appetites. That these appetites become more sophisticated so that consumption is no longer restricted to the necessities, but on the contrary, mainly concentrates on the superfluities of life, does not change the character of this society, but harbors the grave danger that eventually no object in the world will be safe from consumption and annihilation through consumption. She doesn't pursue this here, but if you have time, and a library, or something called the internet, I encourage you to take a look at an essay she wrote called The Crisis in Culture, which is in a book called Between Past and Future. And in that book, she makes the argument that a culture of consumption, that a consumer society creates vacant time such that it demands ever-increasing efforts to satisfy a craving, hungry people desperate to fill their time. And that what you create in such a society is what she calls the educated Philistine. The educated Philistine is the one who occupies himself with culture, because culture raises his or her status. and that the culture industry becomes taken over by the entertainment industry, and art becomes entertainment. And the greatest example of this, and the greatest danger she sees to culture, is adaptation. Adaptation of Shakespeare for movies, or adaptation of Sophocles for whatever. And the argument is that instead of people actually reading the great works, they read annotated, easier versions, or see annotated, easier versions of them, and attempt to create, and she says, it would be better to not read them at all than to read them in adaptation. You could even say the same thing.